Hi everyone, so I'm Amol, and this is like my third meetup and I'm presenting, so thanks, thank you Ansel for this opportunity. So I'll just tell a bit about myself first. So I am a first year PhD student at UCSD in the Mechanical and Aerospace Engineering Department. I specialize in robotics. And my hometown is Bengaluru, it's in India. And so I previously did my master's in Boston University, and most of the work I'm going to show here is part of my thesis and my projects there. And so my interests in general are human swarm interact. So I like to interact with robots, and I mean they have autonomous behaviors, yes, but I also like to humans to be in the loop, and I want to interact with them in an intuitive way, and yeah, so I like those aspects. And of course, yeah, or anything robotics, I just use. So about this talk. So this talk has a variety of aspects, and I'm just going to give a brief introduction to most of them. I'm not going to go in deep into any aspects. And it's like, yeah, just first I'll probably introduce a bit of what is swarm robotics, what is the, you know, the whole fuss about this, or what are the intuition behind how things work. After that, I'm going to give you what I did in my master's. I had this framework where I used like thoughts and gestures to control these swarms of robots. So I will just explain how I did that. So let's move on to part one. So before we start, have any of you seen this? No? So this is Intel's drone. They recently did this. They call this shooting star, and they wanted to have like displays in the sky using drones. So all of these are individual drones. This box. So they use 500 of those drones to come up with this display. And right now they're doing it in Disneyland and anything. So this is going to come up with. This has just happened over the last. Creates an expression of
art. This is something that we never could have done last year. It's been an amazing experience just to see the technology develop so quickly.
So just a motivation to why swarm robotics. So what are robotic swarms exactly? What are they? So the common ingredients are, we have multiple robots, of course. And then they kind of coordinate autonomously. Like they not only have their own behavior, but they talk to like their neighbors or talk to some other members and do something. And they are all based on local kind of control laws, in the sense that you try to go, you know, one step forward, the others try to go similarly, and you end up having this emergent behavior. So that is what like swarm robotics is about. Where, you see, individual movements may not make that much sense, but overall, when the big picture comes, the whole swarm, they would do something nice. So that's the concept behind swarm robotics. So why do we need these things, right? So the most important thing is like it's robust to failure. Like there are like 10 members in your group, you remove one and still the group would perform the task what they are given to. That's like one of the key important points. And then you see some single robots cannot perform certain tasks. Like for example, what you saw there, the display, a single robot cannot possibly do that. So you need multiple robots in certain things. And then you have very simple robots and they can produce really complex behaviors. Like you have, those were just LEDs. They were just LEDs flying in the air, that's it, each of them. But then they could create this huge display. So those kind of things. And then most of these are bio-inspired, and we know they're already working in biology with all the swarm collection of animals, how they behave. So we try to do biomimicry to get things working because we kind of know that it's already been working in nature. So what are the typical, you know, behaviors we're after? So one is like formation control. So these are actually developed in, I think, Harvard University. They call it kilobots. So these are all individual robots making some kind of a pattern. And then the other is like you're going as a team, suppose you want to avoid obstacles, and these are like UAVs doing that. I think this is in UPenn. And this was in my previous lab where they tried to, they used the philosophy of how ants move collectively a big object, and they had this sort of leader-follower approach where the they collaboratively move a box kind of thing. And then the other big thing is called coverage, where there's usually a disaster situation, there's something happening, and you want these kind of aerial drones to do surveillance over this area, try to set up some network which is lost, those kind of things. So yeah, those are the standard applications. Yeah, environmental monitoring, coverage, search and rescue, entertainment, like you saw, create displays and stuff. Construction, so there are also cases where drones collaboratively carry like blocks up and down. Like further in the future, if they're more powerful, you can carry like bricks and stuff, which would be quite useful. And then yeah, herding. So the way these algorithms are designed, they kind of are inspired from many simple phenomena which we see. So one is from nature. You see like birds, they do this flocking behavior, which is quite natural, and we try to mimic these things. And ants, what I mentioned. So, and also society. Society also, we have like always, we can consider ourselves swarms in certain cases where we have our own individual behave, like sort of individual things we want to do, and there's also this collective thing. And you see like crowded markets or anything, and we can take inspiration from that and how we navigate and how we things. And yeah, feel free to stop me anytime to ask questions. And also from physics, so there are these forces, and we can create some kind of artificial forces or something like that to control a group of agents. I'll come to that soon, how to do that. So yeah, so based on this, so any guesses, like how, say suppose you were given a swarm of robots, how do you think you would like to control them? What do you, the control architecture?
Spoke and wheel, the hub, and then spoke.
No, I mean like just like say you have multiple robots, say all of you guys are robots, and I want to control you guys to do something. So what do you think I should do? No, something like an intuitive guess. Sorry.
Radio control.
Yeah, you could, one thing, you could broadcast everyone, say, oh, you do this, you do that, you do this, you do that. So that's one way.
No, I mean, like one robot radios out to a nearby neighbor and receives it.
Yeah, so yeah, that's one of the approaches where...
not central control, but decentralized.
Yeah, decentralized. So where you communicate with your neighbors communicate with their neighbors communicate with their neighbors. They finally like have this picture of what to do, and they do. So that's one way to do. So let me just give you a brief. So one is this puppet master approach with the drones you saw, the Intel actually does this. They don't have decentralized approach yet. So they have the central controller, which has already pre-planned the trajectories. They run that program, and they like have these drones form. And the other is this leader-follower approaches, which birds use. They have this one leader. So all you have to do is control this one leader robot, and the rest of the follower robots will do well. So that's one way to do it. This is a very interesting video where these farmers, they control sheep, and they do cool things for this. I don't know if you guys have seen this though. So they control these dogs, and they're able to create shapes or sheep. So they essentially control these artificial agents, and they make the sheep out of sheep. Sheep out of sheep. They're just controlling dogs. So sheep are, they're scared of dogs, so based on that. And they do other fancy things for them, like cleaning and stuff. And they play ping pong and things. The video goes on for something like that. Yeah, thank you. But you guys take it. So the other thing is these physics-based interactions where, you know, there's like magnetism based on magnetism. You can create artificial magnets and artificial forces. Like, for example, here, like, we as humans, we are kind of not comfortable when people are too close to us, right? So we try to move away. But if we are talking to someone and they're really far away, you try to come closer. So based on this, you can have these forces which can drive, get you into some configuration. Like, for example, I just coded this up in MATLAB quickly. So there are these three agents there, three robots in the circles, and here the forces are represented. So what happens is these guys are far away, and you see there's these forces mathematically created, and they kind of raise and they start coming closer. And once they come too close, there is repulsion acting, and they finally are equilibrium. So using varying these forces, you can make them move in the way you want, most of the time. So this is one way where you can have these artificial forces. And
so you have a force field, we basically try to look for the equilibrium.
Yeah, so you have a potential created, and then you just move along the gradient.
Okay. So not really controlling them, just dictating what the potential is. And
yeah, so you dictate, yeah, so that's how. In most of SWAM is about indirect control. You don't want to control all of them, each of them. Yeah, this is just a matter of two gains and your math. And the other is just, you know, like nature. Their nature does a lot of different things. Like locusts, for example, are interesting. They tend to eat each other, so they're driven by, they try to go as fast as possible away from each other because they kind of eat each other. There are many of these animals in the world. So yeah, based on these control architecture, there's some general hardware requirement which most SWARM robots, when you want to design, will need. So one is communication. So the essential aspect of robot is communication. Where you need to communicate with your neighbors or someone to know what's happening. And then the sensing. You need to sense your environment and your neighbors. And then, yeah, localization, that's the key aspect. Well, there should be someone or where they have this sense of where I am, kind of, to drive this on to some positions. So that is kind of what most of now research is kind of stuck at, because we don't have good methods of localization. GPS would not work because it's not very accurate. And then, yeah, distributed. All of these agents need to have some sort of computation to do some calculation. These are like some sort of hardware requirements. And yeah, of course, they need to be individually to be able to move well. So now, this is like a very, very, very brief introduction to SWARM in general. Any questions? I'm just going to move on to my next part, how I control these robots.
How do you prevent the collision?
So again, with the repulsion, so you can create a force saying that that force acts when you get too close, which makes you pull apart. So when I start moving closer to you, if I get really close, both of us kind of feel uncomfortable, so we kind of move apart. So we can do, we can simulate similar things in both.
So with the potential approach, how big of a swarm can you have before you start losing the performance you need for real-time interaction?
You could have, so again, there'll be decentralized approaches where you don't have to know the entire, you don't have to communicate with the entire swarm, you just have to communicate with the neighbors. And that can produce the same results as if you would have communicated with the entire swarm. So technically, at least mathematically, I think any large number, as long as there needs to be some neighbors, in the sense that we call that connectivity, where one robot, say, has to have some communication with others. So if there's one isolated robot, you can't do anything with it, because he can't know what's happening, and he will be doing something on his own with the rest of them. As long as the communication is active with all the agents.
And the neighbor recognition is not based on any communications, right? But you communicate.
So that's where you need your sensors, or you need communication, or both.
So what kind of communication do you use on a low power device?
What? like specific technology?
Yeah.
I've used Zigbee. Zigbee is the low-power device. But yeah, it has its own limitations. You can't have many. It doesn't have a good enough bandwidth. Anything start. Bigger networks. So that's again another bottleneck, I would say, right now, because reliable communication is, once you have like large number of agents, you have these delays that cropping up and the algorithm starts getting performing differently. So this is basically, I've used the potential base method to control like these robots with using thoughts and stuff. So I'll go through that. So basically, I kind of was fascinated by that idea of, you know, controlling robots using thoughts. And just when you see that in these cartoons and any movies and stuff, but yeah, you can do it in real life. I'll show you soon. So in this part of the talk, I will go through various aspects from bit of neuroscience to, you know, signal processing to other things. And it's going to be very brief. So if you need any more information, please stop me. So we have these two kind of interfaces where one, I use this Myo armband. Have you guys heard of that? So you wear this on your arm. And it kind of measures your muscle signals. So when you're doing gestures and stuff, you have these electrical signals where you can do some decoding. And it also has a 90-degree of freedom IMU. So you can measure your motion and gestures. And then that is called the Emotive Epoch, which is a EEG headset. EEG stands for electroencephalography. Basically measures the electrical signals from your scalp. So your brain is kind of, there's this field sort of on the scalp, which is very, very tiny and noisy. And you pick that up and you filter it out and do stuff. You kind of roughly have something which is going on. And they have like about 16 electrodes there with 16 positions all the way ahead, and you have these spatial signals coming. So based on these four technologies, I would say I would do this framework. So yeah, this has aspects from sciences, from neuroscience, you know, from nasal kinesiology. Then I take those aspects, use signal processing and machine learning to decode some signals, and then I use those to, with control theory and swarm robotics, to implement it on robots. So why do we need this? So I feel this need for intuitive interfaces. Where you see the joystick, it's quite complicated if you want to control a swarm. For example, like all those buttons and stuff, you need to get used to it. So what if you can just do like, you know, spread or like compress, spread them around this way? And I feel that is more intuitive and it can be developed. And again, with your thoughts, like though we haven't reached that stage yet where we can think and we are able to decode our thoughts exactly, but there is some rough things which you can do, I feel, which are aiming towards intuitive interfaces. And also, many of these technologies will also help in disabled people controlling these robotic swarms, which like standard HCI devices won't, like for this mouse and stuff. So in that case, I think they use the exact Myo armband. I think this is Applied Physics Laboratory in JHU. Where the man could control the robotic arm. And this is actually an instructable on how to make a brain controlled wheelchair. So using the same Emotive Epoch, there's an instructable on how to make a brain controlled wheelchair. And then yeah, I also like it because it's cool. So now very briefly go into these science aspects. So what we have in the brain is very, very complicated, and I'm no expert at that. So I'll just tell you what briefly I know. So we have this thing, the surface of the brain. So there are many centers for that. Like you have areas of vision, areas of, you know, sensory motor. And it's called the cortex, which is very thin. So that's where most directly we can access these signals from the scalp, because we don't know anything what's happening deeper because the signals are not there. They get all, they become noisy because we have this huge thick skull running, which makes the signals noisy. And yeah, so this is, if this is the top view of the head, and this is where the sensors are placed. This is like a standard So the interesting thing about the brain is there are many ways in which it works. One of the things which we still haven't understood is it works something like a machine which kind of vibrates at certain frequencies. So if you're like sleeping, the frequency of vibration is lesser. As you get more excited, your brain starts vibrating in these higher frequencies corresponding to certain areas. It's a very interesting process, but we still don't know why they happen. But yeah, you can see them on EEG. So on the scalp, when you see these electrical signals, if you do like a frequency, like a Fourier transform and stuff, and you get those peaks in those certain frequencies, which is kind of very nice. So, and this is the neuroscience, the EEG aspect. I'm going to use that. There are many other ways you can use these EEG signals to control, but there is one other way. So, and again, the same thing with muscles is these muscles are oriented typically in a certain way, and you have these surface sensors. They have like two sensors. So what happens is when the muscles flexes or contracts, there's a dipole created which creates this field. And measuring field at two different points will give you the values exactly. And you can use them to, you know, you get your basic values from spatially oriented on your arm. So that is like EMG, you have muscle potentials. And similar thing with your eye. So what you can do is you can stick electrodes on two sides of your eye, one on top and one in the behind, and you have some reference. So whenever you move your eyes, you can actually see that. So when you move your eye to the right, so if your eye moves to the right, then there's a positive deflection here and a negative deflection here. So it's like, again, a dipole. Your eye is a muscle, basically. It's a dipole. So you can read signals of these electrodes and determine where you're moving your eyes without using visual or without using any other thing. So that's like called electro-oculography. But the essence is the same. There's some dipole and there's some field, and you use these sensors to measure. And now I'll tell you. So using the myo armband, I have like two different signals. They're the IMU and the EMG signal. So I use these to specify shape. So I draw the shape and then I make the agents go to that shape. And in the EEG, I think the way I do this is each of my thoughts. So if you think something relaxing, the brain kind of produces a signal which lesser frequency. If you think something exciting, your brain kind of vibrates faster. So I just use those two things, and I control the attraction and repulsion of the swarm. And then using eye movement, I move the swarm. So that's how I control using like thoughts and gestures. I mean, eye movement. They're like two different systems.
Can you go back to that? Sorry.
Yeah, sure.
One more back. What is that formation?
It is part of my. So for, it's just a way of telling a formation. This is like a
relative. T-star using KNN.
Oh, yeah, KNN. So I use. KNN, K nearest neighbors, to train, and it's a machine learning technique for it. I specifically train it initially by, you know, doing these motions, and then later when I do a particular shape, it recognizes which shape it is. Simple KNN.
So you do training on the EEG?
Oh no, this is the myo armband. This is with.
Okay, you do training with the myo.
Yeah.
And then you can, and then you, what are you training exactly? You're training.
Okay. So we, there are IMU signals. So there's this magnetometer. So at a point, I get my angle with respect to my arm. So there is a 3-degree angle. And then, so those signals are like the features. And given the shapes, right? So I combine it with the gestures where I do a fist. And then it records that point. And then I go here, I do another fist, it records the second point.
So you're mapping, essentially,
yeah,
the signals that you get?
Yeah.
Or is it training a neural network to...
Oh, no neural network.
Okay.
This is just... So what it's going to do is essentially just find the closest. So if I have like a set of... Say, KNN is basically this. So suppose there are two kind of... So this is the left, this is the right. And wherever I'm closest to, I'll be considered as that class.
I was more interested in how you interpret the signals that you get from the from both the EEG and the EMG.
Yeah, I'll come to that.
So. Oh, okay, sorry.
Next is the decoder.
Okay.
Yeah, so now, so these brain signals, we tried a lot of things, and the really good headsets are really expensive. They can go up to like $50,000 just to read your brain signals. They are really expensive. The medical grade ones which you find in hospitals are that expensive. So of course, I mean, I was working with in a robotics environment, and we don't really have funding for that. So we got this. This emotive is essentially a sort of a toy, which is not very, probably the neuroscience community would not even consider it an EEG. So we used those, and they were really noisy. And somehow these guys have come up with these metrics based on what I said about all these vibration frequencies. They, at a point, they tell you from 0 to 1, what is your meditation level? What is your excitement level? What is your valence? And what is your frustration? And that is their proprietary algorithm. So at a given point, they have the 0 to 1 scale, which gives out how much are you meditating, how much are you excited. So we use those for our, so we have this hidden Markov model framework. If you guys have heard of that?
Hidden Markov? Yeah.
Okay. So I use that to train and decode thoughts in this case. Yeah. So these are something like this. The raw signal is something look like that. There's a 0 to 1, and there's these 3 different metrics that is like, and it's trained over like 60 seconds. And then I get this kind of classification. Where here it's like I have these 2 thoughts. One is like relaxing, like just, you know, imagining I'm going to be just something like that. The other is like I'm calculating the Fibonacci sequence, exerting myself. So at a given time, it classifies, so 0 and 1 is the probability. It says that at this time, what is the probability that I'm in state 1 or state 2? So it's very clear, it's nice in the sense that it's like 0, it clearly states that, okay, at this point, you are at that thought, or you're at this thought. So yeah.
And this is your hidden Markov model, right?
Yeah.
How good is it? Is it pretty?
So for 2, it's good, 2 thoughts. And honestly, it's like I just kept doing it on myself. So I don't know, some people might think better. It's like so, I'm not kidding. So it's very, very hard to keep a thought constant for 10 seconds. I mean, I could meditate better after doing this project. So it's very hard to think straight.
And does this then transfer from one person to the next, or would you have to retrain the model on the next person?
Yeah, we have to. Yeah, all of us think differently. And for these, the IO armband, I do these, like, up for number of, I decide how many drones I want to control. I'll be like 1, 2, 3. And I have these gestures, and similarly. So this is a lot cleaner because the signals are, I don't have the features here because I want to shorten it. So again, these are like 4 like states. One is like, and I keep doing these gestures in a sequence, and then yeah, the decoding is quite clear. have these four different classes, and it tell you at a given time what is the probability that I'm doing this, this, this. This is the column. So this is quite. This was really accurate. Actually, it was giving me over 90-95%.
Another HMM.
Yeah, another HMM. Yeah, so for the other part, so I was telling you about the eye movement detection, right? So turns out this EEG headset can be used to detect eye movement because they have positions, they have electrodes all over here, I mean, all over the head, and some of them really can listen to your eyes. So the ones right in the front, they have, you can see deflections in them when you move your eye. So I thought, okay, why not just use this? And so using these two positions, like the extreme left, I can do left and right detection, and using the up ones, you can do top and bottom. So yeah, so this is how, this is just a no machine learning or anything, just an analytical. These are the signals, what you see up and down. No, left, and this is for the horizontal. You clearly see these peaks when I'm moving. So this is up and this is down. And in the left side, there'll be, if I move left, there'll be up there, and here in the right electrode, it'll be down. So there'll always be these opposites. And you just like subtract them, you'll get better peaks. It's a pretty good. But the thing about vertical is there is no electrode below your eyes, so it's kind of a little more trickier, but it's still easier because it commonly gets confused with blinks. When you blink and when you actually move your eyes, kind of similar, the muscle movement. So blinks appeared much sharper and the actual eye movement appeared spread out, so I just used analytical way to just do it. So you have up and down, left and right, and your thoughts. And for formation, so this is what I would do. So I would stay, and then I would record a position, I would do a fist, so I would record that position, and I would move the fist, record this position, move the fist, be able to triangle. So I have these set of shapes. Which,
how fast could you do those?
Real time.
That, okay.
Because all the IMU was good, so it depends on the IMU, and the sensors were like really fast. The EMG, EMG sensors were about 200 hertz, and the IMU was 50 hertz.
Are those, how are they connected? Bluetooth or what?
Bluetooth. So now, yeah, this is the decoding part of things in a nutshell. Go into details. So now the formation control, I think you've already seen this. So I did a similar, but I did many agents, but this is just there are some results. So in order to implement this, this was a very tough task because I was like this guy trying to do all the things at once. So the emotive epoch records data and it sends to the computer. And so inherently in SPOM robotics, you can't I was saying localization is very hard. So people cheat usually in even research in many places, and they have these cameras set up. It's called like, there are different versions, OptiTrack, there's Vicon. So what those cameras are, they like spread out across the room, and they only emit and receive infrared. So it's like your Kinect, if you've seen, but it's a much better Kinect. And what the robots usually have, these tiny little, I don't know if you can make out, there's these tiny balls which are like your bike reflectors, which only reflect infrared. So then when these cameras see these, they only see these balls. These balls are in certain patterns for each agent, and that's how they're able to localize. So most of what videos you see, all the cool videos about drones and indoors, is all like technically cheating. I mean, little cheating because it's not exactly decentralized. So yeah, we have to do that. So there's this camera system which records all of these, and then that sends that data. I have to put all of that together and finally produce. So this was something which we actually gave at a workshop in this conference called International Conference for Robotics and Automation. So yeah, this is the same. So it's playing the videos, shows both simulation and experiments and some results. Though they weren't that accurate, but it was just a start. So my task was basically have this kind of area. These are like about 128 robots simulated points. It's very kind of not clear to see, so I would kind of move these. And I would try to think, I think one of the kind of drawback with this was, it was very hard for myself to control my thoughts. It was like, so they kind of change in size, depending on the thought, I think. Here I was supposed to like, contract because the area is smaller and this is speeded up. So, can I look? Yeah, so then I use these robots.
Yeah, they calculate a Fibonacci sequence to get it to contract.
Yeah, and there was a lot of work.
And then meditate to get it to expand.
Awesome. So there's three. So we were kind of short on robots at that time because a lot of people were using. So it's not very evident, but you had more. And the thing is, the more robots you add, the communication gets complicated and things start becoming. Because the controller I was using was not dealing with communication delays and stuff, so I wanted to keep it simple. This is just like, but once that actually moves, you feel like, oh, okay, I'm actually controlling things. Right now.
Overall, what's the elapsed time of this?
Probably in my, it was probably about 2 minutes.
Okay.
2.5 minutes. For one run, like this is a really probably like this much.
Yeah, no wonder you're tired after that.
Yeah, this is a big, wow. It was a mental exercise. Yeah, like I'm wearing that thing there.
Is that why you had your head shaved in the previous slides?
Yeah. So yeah, signals, I mean, obviously there's hair, so you want to avoid that. This was sort of the result. So the decoding is sort of okay, just that whole pipeline of delays and the actuation and all that doesn't make it look that great. But in terms of decoding, it's kind of fine. You see there, like at the first segment, I have basically in the dispersed state, which is the red, and yeah, it goes on. And I was somehow able to do this really well, and then.
So positionally, are you using your eyes to get it to go around that square?
Yeah.
And how much practice did you need?
Not much. I mean, probably would have done better with more practice. So this is a deadline, and I was like, in 3 days, throughout day and night. And
so very little practice time, actually.
Yeah.
But it was successful.
Yeah, that's one thing which really
helped. So had you had more time, probably.
Yeah, probably I would have tweaked. Yeah, and this is the experiment. This is like the center of the three, and these are the three. You see, and they weren't even holonomic because they were differential driven. And they would like always, and those robots were really bad. They were like called the M3Pis. I would, guys, I would ask you to avoid those if possible. They are not good. And they use XB for Zigbee to communicate, and their actuation is really bad. If you ask them to go straight, they would always go this way. And then for the Mayo armband, so I wanted like, okay, let me try controlling drones now, the ground robots. So I have these parrot mini drones. Have you guys seen that? So they're these tiny little drones. They're about the same size as yours. And, they have these. You can control them through Bluetooth, and they have apps and stuff. They're not that, they're about probably $100. So yeah, again the same system. So for this though, the drones, they're not meant to operate as a swarm, so they never, I don't think their firmware existed to sustain like multiple communications in a very fast manner. One robot was great, two was okay, three it started getting bad. I mean, I think it was just the inherent firmware. So I could get it to take off and, you know, come together, but it would never sustain and start drifting because it would just not communicate well.
Would the bandwidth be saturated at three, or what do you think is happening?
I don't know. There were these delays, which is really weird. Maybe the bandwidth was bad. And I again had really limited time. This was like, both of these were done in a span of like six, 7 months. And I had to learn a lot of these. It was in my master's. So. Yeah, I guess so. There was a lot of delays. Like, it would start off well, and then it would just... But yeah, in simulation, they were working. So I don't think it's the algorithm.
Were you controlling three drones at the same time, or you were controlling one and then that one was talking to the other one?
That was supposed to be the case. It was not supposed to be the case.
And how did you transmit signal to all through Bluetooth? Did you have a master that is talking to?
Yeah. So I had these three. In fact, I had like three different programs accessing three different Bluetooth. So they kind of emulated the transmission for each of those.
And this was hooked up to your arm?
Yeah, the armband.
So that means the armband is transmitting signal?
Armband is transmitting to your computer, which processes the signal. So it is this, so the so you do some motion, mm-hmm. and that is recorded by armband, which sends it to the computer. And then the computer is basically running a lot of different things. There are actually three different, how many of our drones I was trying to have three different dongles, because I don't know, multicasting was weird with Bluetooth. It's a lot of delays. And I would see it.
Actually, I have some questions because I didn't quite understand. So the signals that you sent from the armband goes like that, send three different signals, one for each drone, separately?
From my armband? No. Armband would do whatever, like I would just pinching the square, I was just making them. The computer processes that and generates three different signals.
Okay.
And then you send. The human does not have to send three
different
signals.
Okay.
But I can show you a video with one. So I have this to turn on like a car key, and then that is up and down. I use both IMU and EMG together. I mean, so I do this gesture to make it go forward and backward. And I have this, and kind of flip sometimes. And I have this fist to make it flip. And this is like a part-time project. I was part of the UAV club in Boston. Mm-hmm. So this was like a project. Kind of went flipped over. Finally, turn it off with kind of lens.
How much was that armband? That's pretty cool stuff.
I think it was $200.
Not bad.
That's
not bad.
So how about the headset?
Headset, so they have two versions. So they are kind of, I don't like their policy, but they have this version which is like $350. And that does not give you access to data. So you have to do whatever they tell you. Like they have these certain things coming up. And yeah. But the research version, they call it's like almost more than two times more expensive. It's like $800. And that gives you access to data.
But it's the same unit.
The same, exactly. Mm-hmm. And then someone actually went and decoded the entire thing and posted it up. So,
such a yet.
So yeah, this is just like a proof of concept that things can be done this way. I'm pretty sure you can have more robust and more efficient ways using these technologies. It's needed more time. And yeah, it's a really big integration challenge with the robots, the system, yourself, because your thinking is not, you can imagine like 10 seconds if you try to hold a thought, it's very hard.
Mm-hmm.
Just try it and let me know. If you can, you'll probably be my next thing. I'll call you guys too. And the other thing is, I feel biosignals have a very good capacity in human-computer interaction. You can use that. So right now, we actually finished doing that. This Myo armband can be used as a mouse. So I'm just using, I can use that as a mouse and control like whatever. I can make gestures to assign it to mouse clicks. And I can scroll up, scroll down using gestures, and I can move using my hands. Very intuitive. And yeah, similar things. So that's what EEG, the thing is, it's very expensive now, like the good quality headsets. Hopefully in the near future, things cost will come down and help progress for the developer. And yeah, in theory, you get disabled people to access like swarms, which I don't think has done before, but I don't know still what is the exact use of it. Most of these EEG and EMG is used for actually people who can't walk with different neuro disorders. And you can control wheelchairs using the EEG headset. That's for most of them. I feel this is just the beginning in terms of using this technology towards robotics. Yeah, like top knowledge, or maybe you different labs I was present in.
Very cool, man. Very cool.
Is there technology to train your brain?
I think we should develop that.
Like, what would it be? Like, electric shock if you don't do it right?
Ghostbusters.
I don't know. Probably just good old meditation.